Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Let's Learn Dwarf Fortress. This is the fort of Flash Glazed, and as you can see, this is just where we left it last time. We are starting to build beds so that our dwarves have somewhere to sleep. We have made a couple of workshops so that our dwarves have something to do. And we cannot make any drinks because we need an empty food storage item. Now, empty food storage items are either barrels or pots. Barrels can be made of a multitude of materials, but usually in the early game they are made entirely out of wood, so you make wooden barrels. You can also go to the Crafts Dwarves workshop and go in. You can make a ton of stuff here, as you can see, but if you go into the rock menu, you can make pots. Pots have the advantage of A, being made out of rock, so if you need rock, you simply just dig around. Meanwhile, wood you can actually run out of if there's not enough trees that can grow back in time. So eventually you will run out of wood, unless you're in like a jungle or something. They also have another advantage. They are a quarter as heavy as barrels are, which means that dwarves are going to be carrying them around much, much faster than barrels. So while most people will tell you, make a lot of barrels so you can have your food and drinks in it, I would say make a lot of pots that you can have your food and drinks in instead. So we're going to make pots. I'm going to make just 10 pots straight up. So we have something to make our drinks with. And I should let you know that this is going to be the last episode where this is a straight up tutorial, where I show you from beginning to end on how to start playing. Because at this point you've gotten far enough into the game that you can start learning for yourself. You know how to make workshops, you know how to build buildings, you know how to dig and designate things. The rest you can kind of figure out on your own. What I'm going to do in the future from here on in is that I'm going to make very specific tutorials on specific things, like how to use the manager, how to use labor management, how to use some of DFHack's features such as Auto Butcher or Seed Watch, or what else do I use a lot? Well, I use a lot of DFHack things, but basically what I'm going to do, make up ahead, is more specific tutorials. So this is going to be the last episode. So if you have any questions, if there's anything that is not clear to you at this point on how to play, let me know in a comment below and I will answer them. So at this point we have a couple of beds up already. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to query the one of these beds. That's Q, if you remember. And you can see it says make bedroom. So I just press R. Now that's going to be a very small bedroom, but on the other hand it's overlapping the other bed, so what you would instinctively do is reduce it down to like that size, and now it's like an individual bedroom. But this is extremely impractical, because in the beginning this means that every dwarf is going to need to have its own bed. So what you're going to do instead is make this the entire room. And now if you don't have, like I, a door down here that you have planned, then this room is gonna leak out into the corridor. So if you have that problem that your room is leaking, place a door. It doesn't have to be built, but it has to be planned. And it will contain the room. Now, there's a big room. Now the problem is, a dwarf is going to walk in here and claim this room, which means that no one else can sleep there, which is really bad. So what we're going to make it do instead is make it a dormitory, with D. Dormitories mean that any dwarf can sleep there at any time. Now, naturally, dwarves don't like sleeping in dormitories, but it is a very efficient way to have your dwarves on sleep rotation in the early game before you've made individual bedrooms and noble quarters, etc., etc. So, we need to make a couple of doors. Four of them, actually. So we're gonna do that here. AD, 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 AD. A means add new task. D is door. So, four doors. What else do we have? Let's have a look around. We have farms. We have bags. Oh, right. We have gold. I'm gonna dig the gold out. And this was what? Limonite, right. We can make steel out of that. So let's take some... Actually, I can show you this. The how to auto-mine ore. So, down here, it says designating all. If you press A, it's gonna go to auto-mining ore and gems, or designating ore and gems, or just designating gems. Now, if I put this to auto-mine ores and gems, I'm gonna remove these so you don't see them. And then I go to designate, and just mark this whole thing. Oh, of course, economic material. Poopy! That didn't work. My plan was that it would only designate the gold and the limonite, but since gypsum is also an economic rock, that won't happen. So I'm just gonna mark the limonite here. Now you can see these are green, because they're an auto mine. That means if the dwarves uncover any more behind here, they're gonna automatically designate those too and continue digging. This is very useful if you want them to dig out an entire vein, for instance. Now, if this had not been gypsum, I could have done that. But since it was gypsum, that didn't work at all. Boopy. There's more gold, so I'm gonna mark that too. There. Now, what I do from here on is basically just dig down. So I'm gonna make an up-down stair and get ourselves down 15 or so levels and see where we end up. I forgot to switch back to designating all. I am a terrible person. Back up again. And 15 or so levels down. But our dwarves are currently busy digging out all the limonites, so it's going to take them a while to actually get down our dig. Which is probably not the smartest idea I've ever made, but whatever. You can use designations to get around that. What the hell is borax? Borax is apparently a material that I did not know about. So, what do we do? What do I do when I don't understand something? I go to the wiki. Now, the wiki is located at dwarffortresswiki.org. You can look up almost anything on this wiki, so we check borax. Borax is an unremarkable white stone which can be found in large quantities within rock salt and in small quantities within gypsum. Well, that explains that, because, as we say, this is gypsum, so that's why it showed up there. Microline, that is definitely not up here, that is probably downstairs. So, let's have a look. Yeah, they are now digging down. Microline should be a blue stone, if I'm not mistaken. I am apparently mistaken. Isn't microline blue? Yeah, there we go. It is blue. So you can make... if you dig out the microline, you can make blue furniture and things. And the same with, for instance, this yellow stuff. You can make yellow. But this is gypsum, you really shouldn't make furniture out of it, but you can if you want. And as you see, there are now dwarves sleeping in here. Yay! And we now have doors up here. And as you can see, these animals are blinking brown with a down arrow. A down arrow usually means something bad. A brown arrow means they're, if you look at W, wounds, they are starving. If it's a blue arrow, they are thirsty. If it's a yellow arrow, they're distracted, as in they are not feeling good, etc., etc. Now, why are these starving? Well, first off, you can see it's only... If I pause, you can see it's the cows and it's the yaks, or I think that's a water buffalo, but still, it's only those. The others are not starving. These need to graze, they need to eat grass. So what we need to do is make a pen for them. So we go up here, and we need to find an area where... Well, let's just make a zone. You need to make a zone with I. So let's make a zone, like so. And then we make it a pen or pasture, N. And then with the capital N, we set the pen pasture information. And thanks for DF Hack, we now have filtering, so we can press Shift G to get only grazing animals, and then we just add them with enter. Plus and minus will move up and down the list. This means the dwarf will now go fetch that animal and put it outside in this pen, which means they can eat and not starve to death. I nearly forgot that. But that's kind of important. If you have grazing animals, make sure they have access to food, or they will definitely starve. And as you can see, they immediately stop blinking because now they're eating grass. What the hell? Oh wow, he carried him far away. But now they can eat. That's good. Did we find anything useful down here? Diorite. Diorite is a good stone that I usually use for building blocks and whatnot. Okay, they're still digging. Oh well. Have we gotten any pots? Yeah, it looks like we have a stone crafter, don't we? Let's have a look. Stone crafter. Yes, my mason is also the stone crafter. Okay, so he's currently doing both. That's kind of stupid, but still. So he's making the last door, then he'll go back to making pots. Oh, and also we should, as I told you about the dumping, if I press DBC again, you see there are forbidden things here again. So I'm going to just unforbid them and reclaim them so we can get them back. Now he should start making pots again. That means we can now assign someone to make brew drinks from plants. I'm just going to repeat that because we need drinks. If I look with Z at stats, you see we're running a little bit low on meat and fish, but plants are fine and our drinks are slowly dwindling. So that's why I want to make drinks. Because without drinks, my dwarves will die of thirst. Well, technically, I think they can run out of a pool and drink, but that gives them a really bad thought. And eventually, I think they're going to go slightly insane. They're also going to work insanely slow if they don't have alcohol. So drinks is pretty much your number one priority. Right before food. I'm not kidding. Dwarves need their alcohol.
Ugh, make more room. Here comes migrants.
There you are, finally. I've been waiting for you. Alright, so we have migrants. They should be around here somewhere. Where are you? Oh, there you are. To the left. There's a blinking dwarf there in the corner. So, normally the first migrants that come in should only be two, but I guess they got rid of that. The first migrant wave should only be two dwarves. It was hard-coded as such before. But it looks like they've changed it. Either way, these dwarves will immediately run to your meeting hall and just sit there. They do have labors and skills when they come in, so I'm going to show you how to give them new jobs. So we go into unit list and then labors. And now they're all in a complete mess. We can't see who is who here. I mean, you could technically see on their stress level on who came recently and not, but that's not really the best way. What you can do instead is use the plus and minus keys and tab. As you can see at the bottom there, sort by arrival. If I now press plus, they are going to be sorted in descending order, so the newest arrivals will be at the top. We have an additional brewer, apparently. This is backwards. There we go. Now they're sorted correctly. Thank you. Farmer. That doesn't sound very good. Also, you can stop being a carpenter. Farmer. What? Tanner. Okay. And shearer and cook. This is useless. And jeweler. Well, gem cutter and gem setter is, wow, B, that is super high. So that's nice once we start getting some gems. We do not need two brewers right now. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to basically disable all of their... A herbalist we can keep because he can go get fruit. Wood burner is not necessary right now. Neither is a siege operator. A doctor is always nice to have, but what I do instead is that I leave all of these on. So their hauling labors will be active, which means they will be carrying stuff around. So basically, right now they're haulers. Because I don't need them to do anything else. We do need a cook, though. Yeah, we should probably have a cook. Let's see. Cooking. C-O. There, cooking. We have a cook. Our expedition leader is our cook, so we do not need a cook. Alright, fine. We do have a stonecrafter. Though, I'm going to replace my mason. He's no longer our stonecrafter. I'm going to make this woodburner a stonecrafter instead. That means I'm wasting 5 experience levels. So the woodburner is going to have to train himself to become a stonecrafter. But it does mean that I can have crafts dwarves jobs and mason's jobs going on at the same time without one dwarf having to do both. So that should be better. I was hoping we would find something interesting down here, but apparently we didn't, so I guess I'm not spoiling anything for you then. But anyway, I think I've shown you the most important things about playing Dwarf Fortress right now. I don't think there's anything really more that you need to know about, aside from assigning a very rudimentary military force, and you do that with the M key. You get to your military. You need to have a militia commander, so we're going to create a squad from him with C. Right now, it really doesn't matter. We can have metal armor if we want. This is advanced, but you can set up uniforms so that you can tell separate squads or separate individuals that I want you to wear this type of armor and this type of weapon and etc. etc. Right now, archers are actually pretty darn useful, so I'm gonna put them as archers. And now we have a squad called the Climactic Picks. Wow. But there's no one in it. So we need to add people to this squad. And preferably you'll pick dwarves that are not as important. I mean, we don't want to pick our mason or our cook or our brewer because they have stuff to do. So I'm going to go to the bottom here and take our herbalist and our siege operator and our surgeon should probably not. The farmer, yes. The woodburner. And I think that's going to be enough. Now I have a very rudimentary military, and these you can access by going to S squads. Then you have your climactic picks here, and you can select them with A. If you have more squads, they're going to show up in this list as well. And you can give them orders, such as M to move somewhere, or K to attack something, or O to cancel orders. You can also set them to have regular training with schedules and things. You can find that in the military menu, and I will probably show it in a future tutorial on military specifically, but this should help you get started. Now remember, you only have 2 axes because you only brought 2 axes, so no one, or not your entire squad, is going to have axes as weapons. And since I set mine as archers, I don't actually have any weapons for them. I don't think I brought any crossbows, so they're gonna be unarmed. But in the beginning, unarmed dwarves is gonna be enough if it's just wild animals, but once goblins start showing up, you would want to have armor and weapons. But for now, that's gonna be. Now, if I need crossbows, for instance, I just build a bowyer's workshop and make a couple of crossbows and a couple of wooden bolts. These can be used for hunting, and they can be used as sort of makeshift weapons to defend us against wildlife or unarmored opponents. It's not gonna do like anything against an armored opponent like a goblin, but I mean, if you're accosted by tigers and stuff, then crossbows would help. Anyway, before this gets way too rambly, I am just going to end the episode here and remind you that this is the last From A to B tutorial of Dwarf Fortress coming from me. This means that I am not going to show you in a continuous motion, so to speak, on how to play Dwarf Fortress. Instead, I'm going to make separate tutorial videos on very specific things. And you can help me with that, because if you have specific questions on things you want to know about, or things you don't fully understand yet, or things you just want me to show, let me know in a comment below and I will try and make a video about that specific topic. Thank you for watching, and I hope you've enjoyed, and I hope you have learned a lot, and I hope to see you in the comments. Toodles!